I'm Pastor Dave McGee. You know, I've had the joy of going to Israel and leading many trips over the years to there. And I want to let you know about a DVD called The Journey Home. A trip to Israel takes a couple of weeks and costs thousands of dollars. But right now, we're going to offer the Israel DVD, The Journey Home, to anybody for an offering of any amount. And so for around $50 or so, you can get the insights that I share and experience the journey of a lifetime. For an offering of $50 or more, not only will you get the Israel DVD, but you'll also get a teaching on the anniversary of 9/11. It talks about what happened that day, what's happening now, and what's going to happen. Now, the militant Islamics don't want you to have this or know the information in it, but I want you to have it, and God wants you to have it. So I want you to order it now. We've got operators that are standing by right now, so call. You'll be glad you did.
Welcome to Cross the Bridge with David McGee. Let's join Pastor David now as he continues his verse-by-verse teaching of God's Word.
We're in 1 Corinthians 14. It's an awesome passage. Dear brothers and sisters, don't be childish in your understanding of these things. Be innocent as babies when it comes to evil, but be mature in understanding matters of this kind. Growing up. And seeking to be a blessing to others. And realizing that, if you don't begin to pour out, you can start to say, well, I'm not receiving anymore. I'm not being filled. I'm not being fed. And the reality is, you are, but you're so full, it's bouncing off. It's like being full from food and you just can't eat anymore. So you begin to look after people and be a blessing and live this generous life that we're talking about. And again, there is a joy. And I know some of you have experienced this. There is a joy in being spent for Jesus. Amen. Of just being poured out, of going beyond what you think you're capable of. Now, less so in this place, but in the old building when we were doing the three service thing and worship, teaching, worship, teaching, worship, teaching. And actually, a camera followed me around one day because people were going, why is he not out front? And it's like, I would barely have time to run to the restroom between services. At the end of those three services, man, I was... They didn't let me out to talk to people because I no longer made any sense. They're like, no. Somebody's going to ask him a question. He's not sure of what his name is at this point. So let's hide him in back, And sometimes, man, it was beyond tired. And yet, what happened? God would fill me and show up. I really want each person listening to experience what that's like. Because there's nothing like it in the world. It's not anything the world can offer. It's not like being spent making money. It's not like being spent, doing a marathon or something, but being spent for Jesus. Romans 16:19 says, for your obedience has become known to all, therefore I'm glad on your behalf, but I want you to be wise in what is good and simple concerning evil. It's a great verse. Goes along with this verse. Mature in the things of God, but in bad things, in malice, in evil, be like a babe. Be simple. Which tells us, and be careful of this, don't spend all your time studying the occult. Don't do it. I know Christians that fall into that trap. Well, I'm studying the occult. Why? Study the Bible. Now, I have a pretty good working knowledge of world religions. Part of that is of earlier confusion in my life.
You know, I understand Buddha and the Four Noble Truths and all this, you know, Kabbalah and all this different stuff. But I don't study those things. Why? I don't need to. I study the Bible. The U.S. Treasury Department, some of you have heard this before, they don't teach people what a counterfeit bill looks like. They teach them what the real thing looks like. And they get so intimately, you know, aware of what the real thing looks like is that when they see a fake, they recognize it immediately. So be careful of studying all these other world religions. I mean, you know, if you've got somebody who is engaged in those religions and you want to learn about them to minister to them, that's great. That's awesome. I would encourage that. But again, keep that in check. Because this book, man, this book can keep you busy for a lifetime, can't it? I mean, I'm still working on the simple stuff. Love God, love people. I keep you busy for a lifetime. In verse 21, it says, "In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips I will speak to this people, and yet for all that they will not hear me, says the Lord." Now, this is speaking of a prophecy that was given in the Hebrew Scriptures, the Old Testament, speaking to the Jewish people, that God was going to speak to a different people group. And it talks about this in the book of Acts. As a matter of fact, it's a great study when we talk about this gift, because there's seven times in the book of Acts where people receive the Holy Spirit, quote unquote. Five of those times there was a manifestation of this thing we called an unknown tongue. Two of them there's not. What does that tell us? And some people say, well, if you're baptized with the Spirit, filled with the Spirit, you have to manifest in this unknown language. I don't agree with that statement. Why? Book of Acts, 5 out of 7. There were some times when people were filled with the Spirit that they didn't speak in this unknown language. Now, let's go over these a couple passages. But let's be clear. God was demonstrating to the Jewish people that he, in fact, did want a relationship with the Gentiles. Now, some of these Jewish people were spiritually very mature. They believed in Jesus. Peter was Jewish. James was Jewish. John was Jewish. They accepted Jesus as their Messiah. And at first, it was completely a Jewish thing. Do you understand that? As Gentiles, they actually had to have a meeting on whether Gentiles, non-Jewish people, actually got into the church. Aren't you glad that went well? But here's what happened. God moved in the Gentiles. How did they know? Well, told in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 10, verse 46 says, "For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God." Then Peter answered, "Can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" I encourage you to go read this section of a few chapters there in the book of Acts if you can. Acts chapter 11, verse 7 says, "If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God?" That's Peter talking. So God made it obvious he's moving among the Gentiles, in part through this gift. Let me ask you a question. The Jewish people in this part of the book of Acts, they had a relationship with God. They knew the Hebrew Scriptures. Peter walked with Jesus. And yet God gave these new believers gifts. This is great. You know why? Because it destroys one of the myths about spiritual gifts. We think that spiritual gifts are some kind of reward for spiritual maturity. They're not. They're not. They're by grace. God gives, they're called gifts. They're not called rewards or paychecks or earnings. Next life lesson here is God gifts are given by grace, not as spiritual rewards. God's gifts are given by grace, not as spiritual rewards. Which gifts? All of them. All the gifts. But see, we look at people and go, wow, he's got that spiritual gift. He is, boy, I tell you what, he's spiritually mature. Maybe. Maybe not. God just hands gifts out. You need to understand, and you won't hear very many teachers or pastors tell you this, but this does include the gift of teaching. I didn't earn the gift of teaching. God gave it to me. It wasn't that I spent so much time in prayer or I was so spiritually mature that God gave me the gift of teaching. Thank you, God. He just gave it to me. It wasn't a reward for being, you know. And you know what? While we're talking about that, the whole call to the pastoral ministry is not based on spiritual maturity. Glad y'all are sitting down. Now, you may think, well, Pastor Dave was so spiritually mature that God rewarded him with the gift of teaching, with a call to the pastoral ministry. I've got a theory about it. I'll share the theory. You know, for some people, going to church once a week may be enough. I think God looked at me and said, I need you there all week, buddy. I got to keep an eye on you and keep you in fellowship 5-6 days a week. So let's understand this about spiritual gifts. Why? Because then when you receive spiritual gifts and you understand they're a gift, you won't get prideful or boastful about these things. Amen? Yeah, that's a... And see, this helps keep my mind right. When we get letters and emails and be, oh man, I've never heard the Bible taught like this, and you're opening up scriptures to me, and this is so awesome, and people getting saved and all these things, I understand they are receiving from the gift of teaching that I've been given. I can't take a bow for that. All I can say is, wow, isn't God awesome? Amen? And everything that you have, God has given you a gift. Whatever you do for a living, God has gifted you in that way.
We say, well, no, actually, I'm a self-made man.
What an interesting term. Seriously, self-made man? So you were like, what, in the womb, putting your arms and legs together and stuff? Where'd you get your hands and feet? Would you get them at Walmart? No, God gave you those things. If you've got a good mind, God gave you that mind to use. He gave you your hands, your feet, your back, whatever. And He gives spiritual gifts for your benefit and the blessed people around you. Verse 22, therefore tongues are for a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. But prophesying is not for unbelievers, but for those who believe. Some of these scriptures are kind of tough, and that's a difficult one. But okay, so he's talking about the unknown language. It's a sign not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. Prophesying, speaking to people on behalf of God, is not for unbelievers, but for those who believe. Now, here's something that's interesting, and this will help with this verse. He's saying in this chapter that the unknown language is not for the public setting. Follow this. And he says, it's a sign for unbelievers. So the public setting of worship is not really for unbelievers. It's for believers. Let's be clear, there is a balance. You know, I share the gospel every Sunday. I'm about to go down that in just a minute. But our gathering here, the largest percentage of people right now that are here or in Greensboro or viewing on the iCampus are believers. That means our service should be geared around believers. The church as a whole, as a culture, made a mistake, and some of the leaders admit they made a mistake a few years, gearing their whole service around unbelievers. And the reason that was a problem is they start to say, well, there are certain words that make unbelievers uncomfortable. Sin, death, hell, judgment, wrong, evil. Those are, you know, those are words that make unbelievers uncomfortable. So let's not talk about them. But the problem is, then you're not telling them how God wants to set them free from those things. And so if we, and you know what? This was, to me, this was also a confirmation of what I shared before we started about stewardship. Why? Because one of the reasons that we don't pass a plate here is because I know that unbelievers have been so hammered about finances in the church. Now, I don't plan to start passing a plate. If God tells me to do it, I'll do it. I understand that. I don't have plans to do that. But here's the problem. In that, it leaves room for a believer not to understand about stewardship. So when we look at the service, when we look at the community of faith, we have to consider believers, and I do believe we have to think about unbelievers. We have to take time to introduce them to Jesus, but understand that a lot of the service is to the believer. Verse 23 says, therefore, if the whole church comes together in one place, and all speak with tongues, and there come in those who are uninformed or unbelievers, will they not say that you are out of your mind? That's pretty plain spoken, isn't it? I mean, in the New Living Translation, this verse says, even so, if unbelievers or people who don't understand these things come into your church meeting and hear everyone speak in an unknown language, they will think you are crazy. I wonder what he means by that. That's the main and plain of that verse. Is if you walk into church and people are running around, and I've been to these churches, people are running around, and everybody weighs the service on, you know, how many people run around the sanctuary and do this and do that and swing from the chandeliers and stuff. But then an unbeliever walks in and goes, I've been in that environment and invited unbelievers to come. You know, and then I would just pray that that one woman wouldn't do that thing she does every Sunday. You know, I'd sit there. And sure enough, she'd start in. I'd shut my eyes, waiting for the nudge. What? Why is that woman doing that? I don't know. She does it every week. Is that in the Bible? I don't think so. Now, of course, some people look and go, well, the weirder the service is, the more spiritual we're going. Wow, she's doing it again. But the unbeliever was walking going, man, are you out of your mind? Are you crazy? So that's why we have to, in talking about these gifts, we have to think about that. This is our time together. It can be a very emotional thing. But if it's completely emotional, what do you walk out of here with? Just a good feeling that fades in a few minutes? Now, I want, during worship, obviously it's an emotional thing. You feel, you sense the presence of God. But part of that also has to be giving you something that on Monday morning is going to help you deal with life. Helping you with this book. Helping you to understand it. And again, what's Paul talking about? Considering other people. Considering other people. See, because that's what Jesus is all about. Think about who Jesus is. Think about what he did. You want to talk about being other-centered? He was on a throne in heaven. People gathered around him, worshiping him, singing praises, angels praising his name. And he left that to come here to a fallen world, to a place where would people appreciate his ministry, value his ministry? They called him crazy. His own family said he was unbalanced. The religious people accused him of being motivated by Satan and filled with demons. I appreciate it. Not really. Why did he do it? He did it for us. See, God, how can we... God gave us His Son on a hillside in Jerusalem. What do you do with that? That's a life changer. When you realize the goodness and the generosity of God towards each and every person. And He wants to give each and every person forgiveness. You haven't earned it. You don't deserve it. But He wants to give it to you. Why? He loves you. He cares about you. Oh, and He doesn't care about you because He's impressed with you or He thinks you're really a good person. No, as a matter of fact, He knows how bad you are. Unlike everybody else in your life, He knows the deep, dark secrets in your life. And still, He extends a hand towards you saying, you know what? I want to forgive you. I want a relationship with you. And those things that you're holding on to are hurting you and they're killing you. And the selfishness that you're motivated by is going to leave you in misery and loneliness if you don't let go of it. Let go of that. Grab hold of me. I'm going to ask the worship team to come back out. I want to pray. God, thank you for this time together. Thank you for each person listening. Whether they're physically here or listening from somewhere else, God, I pray that they would be drawn to you. I invite your Holy Spirit to speak to us, to speak to them, and draw them closer to you, God. That they would experience right now their need for you. That they would understand that right now they're not in a good place, but they can be. In a much better place, spiritually, emotionally, even physically. God, I thank you for that. Thank you for your offer of forgiveness. In Jesus' name. Friend, God wants to forgive you of everything you've done, all the stuff you've done wrong, all the bad stuff that maybe most people don't even know about. He wants to forgive you. Not tomorrow, not next week. He wants to forgive you right now. His hand is towards you in offering this forgiveness. He's waiting on you. He's waiting on you to make the decision to come to Him, to ask Him to forgive you of your sins. He died on the cross to make this invitation to you. Of the 1,000 steps that were between you and God, God's already taken 999 of them, and He waits for you to take this one towards Him. So won't you, right now, take that step towards Him? If you're watching from somewhere else, you do that through prayer. If you're here in the auditorium, in the sanctuary, I'm going to ask you right now to come forward, come down front. If you want to ask God to forgive you for something, ask God. Maybe you've never asked Him to forgive you. Right now is the moment. Maybe you want to ask God to fill you with His Spirit. Maybe you want to ask Him to give you the gifts that He has planned for your lives. Great time and place to do it. We got folks up here that would love to pray for you. But this can be your life-changing moment. Don't walk past this. Everything can change for you today. What a difference a day can make. And this can be that day. But you have to make that decision. God's already made the decision to offer you forgiveness, offer you gifts. You have to make the decision to receive them. I pray, I hope that you make that decision today. Continue to come even as the worship team shares.
I'm giving you my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you.
Pray with me right now, out loud. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe you died for me. that I could be forgiven. And I believe you were raised from the dead so that I could have a new life. And God, I've done wrong things. And I am sorry. Please forgive me of all those things. And please give me your power to live for you all my days. In Jesus' name.
If you've prayed this prayer with Pastor David, he would love to hear from you and help you get off to a good start as a follower of Christ. We'd love to bless you with a new believer's kit, absolutely free. So please call us now or write to let us know. You've just made the greatest decision you'll ever make.
Hey friend, I'd love for you to come join us here Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. And also you can watch live stream Thursdays at 7 or Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. Also check out the website at crossthebridge.com. We do a powerful, powerful thing to help you grow as a Christian. And, you know, some people call these things devotionals. We call it a evotional because what we do is we email you early in the morning every day a scripture, a life lesson, some encouraging thoughts, and what we call a directed prayer. It's a great way to grow as a Christian. So let me encourage you right now to go to the website, if you're able, right now, crossthebridge.com or aboutthebridge.com and sign up for that devotional. It's absolutely free. We'll send it to you early every morning, and let that be perhaps the first email of the day that you open to be encouraged in the Lord and know that we pray for everybody who receives those emails. So God bless you as you sign up and continue to grow in Him.
Join us again next time and invite your family and friends as David McGee continues his verse-by-verse teaching through the Bible.
I'm Pastor David McGee. You know, I've had the joy of going to Israel and leading many trips over the years to there. And I want to let you know about a DVD called The Journey Home. A trip to Israel takes a couple of weeks and costs thousands of dollars. But right now, we're going to offer the Israel DVD, The Journey Home, to anybody for an offering of any amount. And so for around $50 or so, you can get the insights that I share and experience the journey of a lifetime. For an offering of $50 or more, not only will you get the Israel DVD, but you'll also get a teaching on the anniversary of 9/11. It talks about what happened that day, what's happened now, and what's going to happen. Now, the militant Islamics don't want you to have this or know the information in it. But I want you to have it, and God wants you to have it. So I want you to order it now. We've got operators that are standing by right now. So call. You'll be glad you did.
This program is sponsored by the generous financial gifts of our partners and friends. So visit crossthebridge.com or call 877-458-5508. 877-458-5508.